This week on Marketplace Middle East, planning for the future. What happens to oil supplies if prices remain low? We speak to Algeria's energy minister, Shakib Khalil. Plus, the long road to recovery. OPEC does its bit keeping quotas steady, but can the G20 deliver? An interview with the IMF's John Lipsky.
Hello and welcome to the special edition of CNN Marketplace Middle East. I'm John Defterios. This week coming from the Grand Hofburg Palace in Vienna, the site of the OPEC International Seminar. This gathering of executives and ministers comes just days after OPEC decided to leave production where it is. During recessionary times, there's pressure to keep prices low, but there are long-term implications. Leone Lacani takes a look at the supply-demand equation.
It's OPEC's dilemma.
Of the President of the Republic.
How to keep prices high enough to encourage further investment, but not too high at a time of recession.
The conference was concerned to note that the world economy is in the midst of the worst global economic recession in decades.
Crude prices have suffered from the economic downturn, and OPEC expects oil demand to fall by 1 million barrels a day this year. Weakening demand kept prices below $50, but in a global recession, that's been welcomed by consumers. The International Energy Agency says that oil at $40 would provide a stimulus of at least $1 trillion to the global economy by next year. The problem is, if prices remain low, the world's oil producers are less likely to spend on future production.
It is just a cost where we can invest. With this low price, we cannot have an adequate income for all member countries, and also at the same time we invest, because you need to invest to have more supply in the future.
Add to that today's challenges in financing new projects.
When you think about commercial oil companies having to raise finance to develop oil fields, it's going to be very tough in this environment where credit is very scarce.
And that could create a new concern, a supply crunch. If supplies are cut too dramatically now, when the economy turns around and demand picks up, there may be a lack of supply, and that could push oil prices back up.
It can take, 5 to 7 years from exploration through to production, full-scale production. But in the more onshore, cheaper, more established provinces, it can be a shorter period than that. Even where you have very cheap oil, like in Saudi Arabia, there are other restrictions on getting access to that oil, and it's not always easy for it to be brought to market.
The real concern today, of course, is the global recession. OPEC has cut production by a record 4.2 million barrels a day since last September to bring supplies in line with current demand. It may seem premature to worry about a supply crunch just yet, but in hindsight, perhaps a bit of foresight could have prevented today's economic crisis. Leone Lacani for Marketplace Middle East, Vienna.
Oil producers have long argued we're lacking foresight these days, and they say poor planning now will come back to haunt consumers. I sat down with Algeria's energy minister and the former president of OPEC, Shakib Khalil, and asked him why he thinks it's not too early to plan for the future.
Everybody knows that we need between $70 to $80 to justify, development of the tar sands in Canada or the deep offshore, in Brazil. So there is no doubt that unless we get that, there will be lots of investment that are not going to be done. And consequently, we are not going to have the supply when it's going to be needed when the recovery comes on board.
Could we have a case, Mr. Minister, where we go back to peak oil from 2008, averaging around $100 a barrel, and a V-shaped recovery to 2013 if you don't make the investments now?
Well, probably, because you're not going to have, the supply at that time. That's going to need to meet the demand. So basically we are, going on the same type of picture we had in 98. 98 was the year we had low prices, we had these investments, and consequently in 2003, 2004, when, the economy bounced back, we didn't have the supply. So we had tension in the market, and we had $50, prices. While in 98, we were talking about between $10 and $15.
Near term, you're making a direct correlation between equity prices and oil prices, and we've saw a slight recovery. I'm not sure if it's a sustained recovery.
Yeah.
What happens in 2009 if we get an equity rally? Does it play right into the oil market for the second half?
Well, I think so. I think this hope, you know, that the economy rebounds, you know, gives lots of hope, you know, that things would be better. So it's psychological in that sense. And consequently, you know, because of this correlation, I think we've seen, at least in the last few months, we assume, you know, that with the recovery, we're going to have a better demand for oil, and consequently, the prices will be supported.
Coming into this meeting, you were one that was arguing for additional cuts and compliance. The group opted just for compliance. Is this a gesture to the G20 to give it some breathing room?
Well, I think it was, like I said, responsible. It was, you know, move that takes into account, you know, the chance that we need to give to the G20 to do its job and not to have an excuse saying basically that we are sabotaging, you know, the recovery by ensuring, you know, higher prices. So they have a chance now with lower prices, you know, to ensure that they come up with the right measures. For the moment, yeah, I think we are giving, you know, the benefit of the doubt, you know, the G20 to implement those measures. We are also giving the benefit of the doubt to those who have not implemented the cuts, so we assume that the cuts will be implemented fully.
From your vantage point in the energy business, is the G20 taking the right approach? There's an argument right now it's just shooting way too wide.
They need to focus, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you know, on really making sure that credit, you know, is available, you know, to consumers, to investors, to whoever needs, you know, to invest to create jobs, because that's the bottom line. And unless, you know, they deal with that, I think they will be wasting their time.
Oil producers want to be seen to be doing the right thing during this global economic downturn. Now they're hoping the G20 can do the same. Coming up, I'll speak to one of the key players in the G20 process, John Lipsky of the International Monetary Fund.
China reduce its reliance on coal-fired heating plants and prevent 60 million tons of CO2 emissions? When Emerson takes up the challenge, it's never been done before, simply becomes, consider it solved. Emerson.
Experience wild beauty.
In an economic downturn, it's time to cut costs. There's a place in Europe with a tradition of excellence. 0% tax on retained earnings, 10% corporate and personal income tax, skilled workforce, €430 average gross monthly salary, macroeconomic stability, excellent infrastructure, EU and NATO candidate country, free trade access to European markets. Invest in Macedonia.
The international energy community gathered here at the Hofburg Palace in Vienna to look at the impact of the economic crisis on their sector. Demand has obviously taken a hit. So when can they expect a recovery? It's a question I posed to John Lipsky, the first managing director of the International Monetary Fund.
Given the virulence of the downdraft in the global economy in the fourth quarter of last year and seemingly right now, even with a decisive policy effort, it looks to us like the second half of 2010 is going to mark when the global economy will be back to positive growth.
What would you say is the best way to move up that timeline?
First is to restore the functionality of the financial system, and that requires liquidity provision, getting bad assets off of balance sheets, recapitalization of damaged institutions.
The IMF is suggesting that 2% of GDP should be spent on stimulus packages, but so far only 5 countries have done so. Is it realistic to expect that?
For the group of 20 countries, for 2009, our estimates is they'll achieve about 1.8% of GDP. Not only pretty close, but also unprecedented. There's never been a policy response as decisive as this.
There's a big discussion about increasing the funding for the International Monetary Fund to $500 billion to address the challenges of the emerging markets. At the end of the day, candidly, John, is that going to be enough when we get through this nasty period?
We certainly hope so, and we think so. But the main point is the following. We need to give confidence to everybody that the International Monetary Fund, the international system as a whole, has the financial resources available to respond to any eventuality.
You have concerns right now that the low-income countries have fallen off everybody's radar, and this could be the next wave of challenges because this has been a G7-led downturn, as you know.
So far, the poorest economies, the low-income countries, have been somewhat less affected by the global downturn, but it's coming their way. And we've been concerned to make sure that there is adequate financial support for the problems that inevitably are going to afflict them.
Do you have concerns that this G20 process could become unstuck over voting rights?
There's a clear consensus of a need to move forward and make global governance better reflective of the realities of the day.
OPEC at this meeting decided not to cut production, take more off the table, and there was a direct link to the G20 here. Is this cooperation going to actually make a difference in terms of the stimulus that goes into the economy?
There's no doubt about it that the decline in oil prices have been an important contributor to the outlook for global recovery. The additional purchasing power represented by the decline in energy prices from their peak is nearly on a scale as large as the fiscal stimulus being added by global governments.
Once again, John Lipsky of the International Monetary Fund. And that's all for this special edition of CNN Marketplace Middle East from Vienna. I'm John Defterios. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next week.